Good morning, and welcome to this online worship service for St. Mark's United Methodist Church for this March 21st, 2021. Here are our announcements for this morning. First of all, Easter signups have already started for the Easter services that will be provided by St. Mark's. There'll be outside services where you need to just bring your chair and find a place. We'll have places for you to sit with your families, and we're going to socially distance and have our masks on, but enjoy Easter together outside in God's creation. Those services are at 6:30, 8:30, and 11 o'clock, and you can find signups on the connections. And it would be important, if you're really interested in the 11 o'clock, to go ahead and get signed up, because there are very few spots left at the 11 o'clock service for Easter Sunday. So please join us for our Easter services this season. We are still offering our Lenten midweek meditations, as well as the midweek Bible study for Lent. So please catch the midweek meditation service. It's at 12 noon on Wednesdays, and it's on Facebook and also YouTube. And then at 7 p.m. on Wednesdays, you can connect with Facebook Live and Pastor LuAnn as she's doing a Bible study on practices we can use to center ourselves during Lent. So please check out those Lenten offerings. Our last announcement for today is that we're in the month of March, and the month of March is Undie Sunday. So we want you to bring new underwear and socks to the church. There's bins that you can find out front, and we're going to be taking all those to the Oaks to people in need. So please participate in our monthly mission this month. That's all in the way of announcements I have this morning, so let us center ourselves for worship. Please join me in our greeting this morning. We take the next step on our Lenten journey, the step of sacrifice. Be with us, Lord, as we take this step. This requires the willingness to give all of our lives to the Lord. Be with us, Lord, as we commit our lives again to you. Come, let us worship and offer our voices of praise to God. Let us open our hearts and spirits to God this day.
Jesus, I love wrong.
Please join me in our opening prayer this morning. Let us pray. You know us well, Lord. You know that we would like the ways of discipleship to be easy, to have the past laid out in a neat line, with the future clearly visible at all times. But part of our journey is obscured by our own greed and fear. You do not block the way to hope and peace. Our own fears provide the barriers. And far too often, those barriers take the forms of alienation and injustice. Write your words on our hearts, merciful God. Plant your transforming love in our spirits as we have gathered this day to bring before you our concerns, our joys, and our sorrows. Hear our prayers for our church and our world. Hear our prayers for all who are sick and struggling. Hear our prayers for those who suffer from the ravages of our prejudice and heartlessness. Hear our prayers for those who live in poverty and whose hope is fading. Have mercy upon us, Lord. Give us courage. Give us hearts of peace and confidence in your all-sustaining presence. We join our hearts as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Hello, welcome. Thanks for joining me today. I have another holy habit for you this week. We're going to talk about service. Now, service starts with having a servant's heart, like Jesus. So we learn how to have a servant's heart by doing the other holy habits, like praying and reading the Bible. But I'm going to talk to you more about having a servant's heart today. Anytime we put others' needs before our own, that is service. Sometimes God asks us to serve right where we are, in our church, in our school, in our home, things that we know and are comfortable with. But sometimes God asks us to serve in places that are outside of our comfort zone. Maybe going on a mission trip to a place you've never been before. Maybe serving in a soup kitchen with people that you've never met before. Serving others makes us feel really good. And sometimes we can be really proud about that we've helped others. But you know what? Sometimes the most special ways that you can serve others are even more special whenever you keep it between you and God. We don't always have to hear, good job, that was such a kind thing for you to do. Sometimes you can help somebody and nobody will ever know, just that person and God. And that's okay too. Let's talk about some specific ways that you can serve. One really easy way is to pray. Prayer is an act of service. When you're praying for somebody else or for our world, you're serving others. Some easy ways to serve at home would be to clean up your room, to put away your dishes after dinner, to help your brother or sister put their shoes on. Simple things. Those are serving. And maybe bigger things would be helping your church to organize a food drive or make a lemonade stand and use the profits to send to Refugee Hope Partners. I bet you guys could come up with some great ideas, and I cannot wait to find out what you did to serve others. Let's have a prayer together. Can you bow your heads? God, we thank you so much for Jesus and for the ways that he served others. Help us to have a servant's heart like Jesus this week. We love you, Lord. Amen. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.
We thank you, Elizabeth, for reminding us of what it means to have a servant's heart and that we're called to have the servant's heart. On this fifth Sunday of Lent, we are hearing from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 20 through 36. And I invite you just to bring yourself down even more. Take some deep breaths if you need to, just to continue to center yourself to be able to receive these words from God. Now, among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will be my servant also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled. And what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven. "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, we acknowledge that it feels good to be in worship, to be in your presence, to recognize your presence, to honor your presence, and to be with one another. You have so much to say to us, and we need to hear your voice. So, Holy Spirit, teach us, enable us to be able to do the thing that we cannot do for ourselves, which is center our hearts and minds. Focus us, God, because there is much work to be done in this world on your behalf. In Christ's name, amen. Sir, we wish to see Jesus. Scripture tells us that some Greeks spoke these words to Philip. Now, they most likely approached him because he had a Greek name. He had grown up in Bethsaida, a town that had a mixed population of Jews and Greeks. Maybe they didn't speak Aramaic, so they needed to find the one disciple they knew that could interpret for them. It's not clear whether these Greek-speaking people were Jewish converts or Gentiles who had come to Jerusalem, possibly to take in the Passover sights and sounds. We don't know if they were dissatisfied with the faith of their parents or if they were looking forward to a joyous Passover celebration. We don't know. Whoever they were, whatever they believed, they were intensely curious about all they'd heard about Jesus. They want an encounter with. They want an experience of Jesus. Well, it's important for us to know that this hardly made them unique at that precise moment. Jesus was rumored to have raised a man named Lazarus from the dead. We know the story, many of us. The tomb, or the man, had been decomposing in a tomb for 4 days. When this rabbi from Nazareth reportedly called him out, "Lazarus, come out." So, of course, people wanted to see the man who could do that, who could do what Jesus had done, to really see him person to person, face to face. So they make their request known to Philip, who in turn pulls his brother Andrew into the action, and together they go to tell Jesus what is going on. Now, here's where the story takes an odd turn. There's no indication that Jesus paid much attention to Philip or Andrew. There's no indication that he ever meets with the very people who said, "Sir, we want to see Jesus." In fact, in verse 21, we hear the request, and in verse 36, which I didn't read, it says, "He departed and hid from them." He departed and hid from them. We're told that Jesus hid himself from these Greeks and everyone else. In John's gospel, Jesus will not appear completely out in the open again until he is nailed to a cross. Wow. I mean, why would Jesus hide? Why in the world would he duck away from some earnest seekers? Because Jesus' hour had come. The time to see him alive had come and gone. Now it's time for him to be hidden in death, which is just what Jesus has been speaking about. "My soul is troubled." And then he says that it's time to die, time to go the way of a kernel of wheat so that greater fruitfulness can be generated. Jesus speaks about light and darkness, words that most likely went over most of their heads. "Then the light of the world hides." So far as we know, the Greeks who asked to see Jesus never did. At least that's what we think. "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Everything Jesus said in today's text is an extended answer to that request. It is if Jesus was saying something like this to the Greeks: "It's okay that you want to see me, but wait a few days. I invite you to come and see me Friday afternoon. You won't be able to miss me." The presence of Greek people in this passage gives us wonderful insight, wonderful hope. Remember last week when Eric brought the message, John 3:16, "For God so loved the world." As Jesus is lifted up on the cross, Jesus will draw all people to himself. Jesus' mission includes not only Jewish people, but all people. Thanks be to God. Many of us would not be here if that were not the case. The entire passage offers us understanding into what is probably the scariest lesson that there is on discipleship. Now, I'll speak for myself here. It's downright scary. In fact, it takes my breath away when I allow it to sink into my heart, into my mind. And here's the lesson in a nutshell. If we want to be authentic followers of Jesus, I mean, if we're going to go the way of sold out to God discipleship, we have to understand that we must be like Jesus, a grain of wheat that falls into the ground and dies in order to bear much fruit. Meaning what? What does it mean? We cannot hoard our own lives. We cannot make our own well-being our top priority. We are called to a higher allegiance, one that is born out of a belief in and a decision to genuinely, again, I'm going back to authenticity, genuineness, follow the Son of Man, who is glorified and who God glorifies, who God is glorified in Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. So if we're halfway paying attention to this, this is challenging stuff. I mean, we're being asked by God to put aside the longings of our egos so that the greater things can be achieved through our lives. Kingdom things, things that transform other people's lives, promote peace and love and justice and compassion in the entire world. We're being invited to understand that for each one of us, and this is without exception, there is a higher agenda. Our lives are meant to be lived for the greater good, not just for personal gain. Now, there is absolutely no doubt, especially when we compare our situation with other people in the world, most of us enjoy great blessings. Beautiful families, friends, challenging vocations. We have astonishing living situations. We have superior medical care, abundant food and drink, especially, as I said, when we put our lives up against so many other lives in this world. But interestingly enough, these things are not the things that are used to measure a life of authentic discipleship. Being given the gift of all of this is not God's way of saying to us, hey, you're getting it right, you're doing what I'm asking you to do, so I'm going to give you an opportunity to get a job that pays more or a chance to drive a nicer car. That is not the way it works. All of these things can be indications of a loving God who leads us into blessing beyond measure, but we are led in the ways that we are led so that we will use our gain to serve others, to help others. You've heard it over and over again, to those whom much is given, much is required. Do God's blessings enrich our lives? Of course, absolutely. Are they meant to be stockpiled for selfish gain? Not according to Jesus. So I want to stop here and just make it clear that I'm not trying to tell you what you need to do with your money or your possessions. What I'm trying to do is help us all understand that all our gifts, health, intellect, time, material resources, love, all of them are given by the grace of God, and that they can be used in incredible ways for the kingdom when we're ready, when we're willing to share. And again, this is precisely why this teaching causes me to stop short. I mean, if I'm going to live for kingdom purposes, I'm going to need to realize that the cycle of living and dying has to happen in my life over and over again, maybe multiple times a day. When I'm choosing how to use the resources I've been blessed with, I have to be willing to submit my own thoughts, my own ways to God for direction. And instead of rushing out to do things on my own way, doing my own thing, we are being called to look to God first. So it will always mean that on occasion, with this cycle of death and life, we may have to suffer the death. What are we suffering the death of? Our small-minded ways. We are suffering the death of our small-minded ways so that God's greater purposes can be achieved through us. And what greater symbol do we have of this than the cross? It looked like humiliation and defeat to the world. God lifted up the one who brings life and salvation to all. I mean, it is a complete mystery to all of us. God brought victory from defeat, all things possible from what looked absolutely hopeless, and eternal life from death. And I'm quite sure that there is not one thing that I have said thus far that we cannot get on an intellectual level. We get it here. But it's the living out of this. And it just ain't easy to do that. One of the things I find most interesting about this morning's text is that Jesus recognizes that the hour has come, but even he's not sure that he's ready. There is a sense here. We hear it. There's a sense of uncertainty. The humanity of Jesus is clearly present here. He recognizes that there's no turning back, though he's open to an alternative, at least for a moment. Nevertheless, he knows that there is no other way. The hour has come. He finds himself once again in Jerusalem, and he's not going to go back home this time. As the book of Hebrews declares, we have a high priest that understands what we go through. He knows how difficult it is to die to our desires because he's been there. And I will add, he's experienced the triumph that can come by letting God take the lead role. God, show us how to do this. God, pour out your spirit upon us so that we have the strength to do it. If this lesson on discipleship ended like a lecture on selfishness, I mean, it's not going to feel like gospel to any of us. It certainly doesn't feel like it to me. But instead, we're reminded of a very basic truth. Out of death comes life. As we serve God, God honors us with abundant life. Our own destiny is one of being glorified with the Son of Man as we're willing to suffer. You see, true glorification takes place when we turn away from our self-centeredness and we follow the example that Jesus gave us of himself, his love, his life that was lived for good, for the good of all in the community. Jesus is the supreme example of one who finds by losing and one who brings a great harvest by dying. Just like the Greeks wanted to get up close and personal with Jesus, I'm going to move into your private lives this morning. And I do that because this is what God is teaching me and showing me, and I need to go here too. Here's what God has laid on my heart. Every single one of us, without exception, is going to be given the chance to live out the truth of this morning's teaching at some point in our lives, probably multiple times. Every single one of us. And it will be impossible for us to move with the flow of the Holy Spirit if we're not willing to let go of the known, with this hope and understanding that God's greater purposes can be served as we work together in love. And here's where I get caught. And please know that every word that I preach to myself. Do we really practice today's teaching enough to understand that we will not be able to have everything in life on our own terms? It's not what the world tells us. I mean, do we connect with the cross enough to know that there is going to be pain? But that's what happens when there's the greater possibility of God's kingdom. Are we going to be able to keep all that Jesus speaks to us in our hearts and minds so that when times get very trying, we're not going to say and do things that we regret? A few years ago, I led a mini Lenten retreat for a group of women and invited the women to look inward, which is exactly what we've been doing at St. Mark's during this Lenten season. Inside out. And I asked them to be honest about relationships and situations that exist in their lives that are not pleasing to God. We had time for confession. We spent some time meditating on today's text. And I was so surprised at what happened to me in a very short period of time. I saw, there it was in black and white, that the circumstance in my life that brought me at the time the most disquiet was the one where my ego was most involved. There was a direct correlation. The place where I did not want to die to my way of thinking and acting was the place in my life where my ego was at stake. You would not be here with us in worship today if you did not want to live a life that honors God. If you did not want to invite God to move in a miraculous way in your life and in the church, the life of St. Mark's, I'm sure of that. The Spirit of God is moving in this church. The Spirit of God is moving in the world. I wonder what would happen if we just agreed to take this spirit of self-examination, this practice of self-examination, beyond Lent. What if we believed that God was telling us and helping us to see truth about ourselves so that we could receive more grace and we could receive healing? Would it not be incredible if we became a congregation of Christians who lived the truth that it is in dying that we receive life? Marked by the waters of our baptism, could we be given the ability to keep the bigger picture in mind? Not what is right in front of us in the short term. I'm going to let Jesus answer this question. And these are the verses directly following the passage for today. Hear these words of Jesus. Walk while you have the light, so that the darkness may not overtake you. If you walk in the darkness, you do not know where you are going. While you have the light, believe in the light, so that you may become children of light. May it be so. Amen.
Before the world was made, before you spoke it to me, you were the King of Kings. Yeah, you were, and now you're reigning still, enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out, we join them as we sing, glory to God. Glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Yeah. Creator God, you gave me breath so I could praise your great and matchless name. All my days, so let my whole life be a blazing offering, a life that shouts and sings the greatness of our King. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever. Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my
for being with us in worship today. It is very important to us. You are a gift. We're moving into Palm Sunday, and after that we know Holy Week and into Easter. Hang in there. Hang in there. Allow this truth of the gospel, this good news of this cycle of dying so that we may live more fully, to penetrate your heart and your mind. Know that God is with you, calling forth more fruitfulness in you. And in those all around us, all of the whole world. Go in peace, and may the peace of Christ go with you. Amen.
Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my